round stress. You did your segment on Ryze earlier. Ryze was banned by SK yesterday. Let's see if either of these teams feel the same way.
Yeah, I'd expect it from a red side, and there, in fact, it goes. Ryze has thrown a bit of a spanner in the works when it comes to the pick and ban phase, because it's another red side ban that is basically a must, unless you're Hoonian, have been sitting on somewhat of a counter pick. But one thing I kind of want to talk a little bit about Giants and their opponents is everybody seems to be trying to ban out Wurlib all the time, and we'll see whether SK go for the same strat, because Wurlib has started to move on.
He definitely has. His Maokai yesterday was particularly impressive, and Wurlib, as a player, I think has grown a little more than the rest of the Giants squad. From the beginning of the spring split, he was only Jax, pulled out the Hecarim at the end, and obviously now showing up in summer.
I actually think that's one of the biggest things Giants have worked on this entire offseason before summer, is they've actually all worked on expanding their champion pool. Giants are going to ban the Gragas here and the Rek'Sai, so at this point, Giants love to first pick at their mid lane here, but LeBlanc, they've actually been the ones to ban this, so normally you'd expect Giants to pick that up for Pep and Arrow here, but not on the table. They obviously do not want Fox on that LeBlanc. I'm trying to look and see what's available. AD carries, Kalista has been banned. Giants, what have they got for us?
Ooh, I'm not expecting the Jax personally. Alistar's available. Eve is something Frederick has played as well. Cassio is still up. Maokai.
Yep.
Hecarim as well. Let's keep that in mind. Wurlib did great with Hecarim in the past. And they're going to prioritize the invisible jungler.
That's an interesting one, because Frederick, while he's a jungler that likes his early presence, it's a very different style for Frederick. He used to favor a lot of the Javans, a lot of the early game damage junglers, and especially against a jungler like Sven, who's going to want to run the same. Now you have to ask, can Sven output more pressure in this early game than Eve is going to passively?
Based on what we've seen in the last three games, I think the answer is no. Sven Skarren is not necessarily playing many of the other junglers. We've seen the Gragas and the Rek'Sai band. Sven's Lee Sin was not great. His Nidalee got caught out multiple times. I distinctly recall Krepo talking about that. And you can see a big discussion in SK camp.
Yeah, there certainly aren't particularly clear picks right now, apart from the Alistar. That's one that we completely kind of skimmed over right now. But this is actually, again, another type of support for N-Rated when you look at it. Yes, he played it last week, but he also played Bard. He played Lulu in yesterday's game. N-Rated seems to not be shy about swapping things up when it comes to his support playstyle.
Definitely not. And that's actually something SK has done very differently in all of their games. Adjusted the way they played, and there's been these moments of goodness against Fnatic. SK looked great, but yesterday against Origin, SK looked a lot less great. So let's see what they can do this time around. 20 seconds left on the clock, and it will be a Morgana, most likely for Godfred, and Audrey will be getting his hands onto that Ezreal. So a little mix and match of everything. Not entirely sure I'm sold by this pick and ban just yet.
Well, Giants opting for the same bot lane that Fnatic just gave us in the previous game. It did show a lot of presence and a lot of ability to stay away from some of the higher crowd control champions when you look at Ezreal being very mobile, Morgana's Black Shield. This resurgence of Morgana does make it very, very difficult for certain champions when you look at top laners with Maokai, that sort of high crowd control, to actually get on a high priority target. And this makes it even more difficult, but Giants are buying time for their solo laners right now. They want to try and get a favorable matchup for either Wurlib or Pepinero. And of course, Wurlib has seen Rumble, but he's just been sat on his options for top lane for a while now.
We'll see what he decides to run into that Rumble. What we do see locked in for SK Gaming is the Sivir for Candy Panda, and we also see the Sejuani locked in. So we'll need to see how well Sven Skarren can perform on this sort of slightly slower jungler. It worked for Amazing yesterday, and we'll see if it can work for Sven Skarren today.
The battle ball is going to go a lot faster with the On the Hunt, though. That is one thing for certain, because that is a fair amount of engage potential here for SK Gaming, and you couple that with the Equalizer. Giants might have to be careful where they fight around areas like Dragon, areas like Baron here, if SK managed to get themselves a lead. But Giants' early game has been so good in the last couple of days that, honestly, it could be difficult for SK to actually get that lead.
We'll have to see if they can. As far as Giants are concerned, honestly, I don't really know what they're trying to go for here. It's a mix and match. There's a lot of range poke. The Jax is locked in for Wurlib. We're expecting that Kog'Maw to go mid lane.
Yeah.
So It's poke from three and then sort of flanking from Eve and all in from Jax. This looks like a difficult team comp to pull off.
It does look very difficult from the Giant standpoint. I mean, yes, Jax is going to be able to split push as yet on the lineup. Nobody is going to be able to stop him late game. That could be a problem for SK, but honestly, this is two champions that need time. Kog'Maw and Jax both need to be able to sit and wait, and with SK having this fairly mid-game focused team composition, I don't think they're going to give Giants the time of day.
One thing that we haven't seen though from SK is a lot of early to mid aggression either. It's something that the team, when Jezzes was with them in particular, and SK did particularly poorly, they were all about the mid-game, and we'll see whether or not that changes. Fox, what does he run into this double AD comp? Will it be Zed? The answer is yes. Fox is going for another assassin to try and accelerate this mid-game power.
Yeah, the one thing about this is, remember, Zed did have that adjustment now on his ultimate. It's only a minor tweak, but now that 1 second extra that before you can go back to. So this is going to give SK that nice round composition when it comes to the damage that they're dealing. Rumble in the top lane, very different from Freddy. We'll touch on that as we go forward. But Fox is going to be able to split push a little bit earlier into the game than Wurlib is going to when it comes to this Zed. So now you've got somebody that is going to be able to kind of counter that side lane pressure. But honestly, SK's, the rest of their composition screams fighting. They want a team fight, and Zed, he doesn't particularly want to himself. So it's interesting from SK that would be their choice, but we'll have to see how it is in game.
Well, two squishy targets from those AD carries might be tugging on Fox's chain, and we'll see whether or not he can make that work out for him. Interesting team comps, new flavor for Freddy on the Rumble. Fox going back to an old staple, because they had sort of fallen out of favor with everybody else. And then Giants, they've gone with double AD with that ranged poke middle. It's worked for Unicorns to mixed results. We'll see how Giants do it today.
Yeah, I'm interested to see that. And I'm also interested, this is a different style again from SK Gaming. And, you know, they have been kind of changing things up game by game. They still haven't found their right mark yet. So we'll see if this is the one to do it.
Well, you guys at home, let us know what you think. Will Jax once again give Wurlib a victory? Hashtag GIA win. Or will Fox on Zed be able to have a bigger impact in this match? Hashtag SK win. We're loading up onto the Rift for the second time today, and it will be Giants at 2-1 taking on SK at 0-3. Gambit put up a strong fight against Fnatic. And this isn't quite top versus bottom, but it's close enough.
Yeah, it's close, but honestly, I feel like Giants, everybody was tweeting it yesterday about how underrated Giants seem to be, and I don't know where to place them yet, because my comments in last week's show were fairly harsh when I said that if they don't improve, that they are going to be fighting for relegation. Honestly, you look at their performances, they have started to improve, and you can certainly look at their strengths in the game. One thing Giants have been a little bit weaker on, and I want to track as we go through this game, is exactly how their warding is. That's kind of been one of the things that slowed them down, is they get drawn into fights against teams who control vision very well. And that is what basically took SK to Worlds last year, was controlling the map well and punishing their opponents' mistakes.
A lot of pressure on SK to do the same. Giants have, I feel, got a lot of room to make mistakes because double AD and the timing is quite difficult to play. We see Sven Skeren, the backup of SK, going for another one of these early invades to get some wards down. 4 versus 3, they pull in support of Godfred. SK now on the wrong side of the river. Wurlib is going to stun up Enrated. Godfred is not going to connect because Enrated flashes away. And all of a sudden, SK get punished for an invade that they started.
Yeah, that was a really weird invade out of SK. I mean, they get vision of the topside jungle, so they may be able to track Eve a little bit better now for this early game, but they just lost flashes across the board. Enrated, no flash. Freddy, no flash as well here. So it opens up possibilities for Frederick, once those wards drop, once his jungle pathing isn't as predictable, to get into the lanes and start piling pressure on him. Honestly, if they can get Wurlib a kill or two under his belt on above Freddy early in this game, SK are going to have a fair amount of trouble when it comes to actually stopping this Jax.
We have to keep an eye on Wurlib. He did, of course, scale a Counter-Strike for his first level. Lane swaps have been mirrored. Adrian and Godfred move their way up top. See, no coin this time round. Godfred's Morgana. Small variation in the previous game, however, obviously, team comps have a big part to play in there. And we are still waiting to see Freddy joining the lane. So Wurlip's been allowed a little bit of free time with those minions.
Yeah, and I feel like Wurlip really was not looking to match Freddy 1v1 before the flash being down. Now, at this point, I think Wurlip may be a little bit happier with it with regards to Evelynn actually giving. But top lane, oh, Binding has landed.
And the Ignite is ticking away. Wow. Abby's looking for it. Ooh. Summon a heal, and Enraged survives on nearly single-digit HP. You do not get closer than that.
But now they have to respect Giants here. They have so much damage down onto Enraged, he couldn't flash away because he'd already used it on that invade. And now the Giants, with this very long range lane for themselves, have so much presence when it comes to forcing SK away from the tower. And if Frederick can join in here as well, they may be able to get a kill. But it's bottom lane, Sven shows his face.
So Wurlip is going to ward hop away, still has flash as well. And Frederick's left the top lane. So junglers looking, but not finding anything particularly impressive.
And Evelynn didn't find any camps in the top side of the jungle either, because still haven't respawned from when Sven was there. But he's trying to get in on the mid lane from Fox. It's difficult to gank a Zed. That is one thing for certain. And it would take a monumental mess up for Fox to actually get caught out too much this early in the game against the Kog'Maw and Anive. They'd have to use that shadow in and be very greedy about it. But he is getting harassed down a fair amount by Pepinero when you look at it. Even on CS though, Fox is just buying time to hit that level 6 mark and look to all in Pepinero with the death mark.
So we'll see how they handle themselves. Waves continue to push against SK. All three lanes pushing, knowing that Sven Skjern needs to really get access to that Glacial Prison before he's an absolute terror for ganking. The Giants are using this early window and obviously the lack of flashes to their advantage.
So back to this top lane matchup as well. You can see the effect it's having not only on crowd control, but Alistar, because he had to heal himself up so much, it means he's used a lot of his mana. He's now waiting for it to regenerate. He also has no health potions left either. So every time they take little engages, it reduces SK's ability to counter-engage using the Alistar time and time again. But bottom lane, Freddy is caught out, no flash.
No, he's not. He's overheating though, getting some auto-attacks down, and Frederick plus Wurlip are looking to get first blood. Freddy still alive. First blood secured as Wurlip slams down with that ice hockey pole. And they manage to make their way out. Very, very close, but it's Giants on the board.
Wurlip's been watching a lot of the Mighty Ducks, because that is a very early kill picked up here in the bottom lane for this Jax. And that is not good here for Freddy at all when it comes to this, because Rumble, you need to get into these team fights being sure that your team has an advantage. If Wurlip's over in a side lane because nobody can 1v1 him, there is absolutely nothing that Giants are going to want to do around objectives when it comes to fighting SK. They've just got to buy time, make sure that SK don't go for the dragon themselves, and they'll just get turrets off it again and again. Giants haven't played this style for a while, though, when it comes to the LCS stage. They've been playing very differently, and Wurlip has been playing a lot more tanks. So can Giants play their old style as well as they've been playing their rejuvenated lineup?
Well, we'll find out soon enough. We do see Wurlip already got their Cutlass picked up, actually mirrored by Fox. He picked his up a minute or two ago. Pepinero has got that early tier, so we'll see how he continues to scale his way up. Early jungle pickups as well, challenging from Frederick. Of course, Orange's Trailblazer there from Sven Skjern.
Speaking of Sven Skjern, this is a different style of champion for him. We talked about how he likes to go to the Nidalee, likes to go for Lee. He's on a tank here, so less early game presence, and he's just face checked into Frederick.
Frederick with that challenging smite, absolutely winning that trade.
This is going to give Sven a lot more freedom later into the game to play like a tank, as Grebo was putting it. Previously, he's been playing champions that need to snowball, and if you can't snowball and you're out of position, then you are going to get caught out. This time, however, Sven Skjern is going to be able to stay alive a lot longer on this Sejuani compared to that video used by Kingsford.
So we do see that Candy Pan has been left alone in the bottom lane as Sven Skjern's helping at the top. We saw Enraged, a quick glimpse of him in the jungle, finding Wurlip out. And Giants looking to put pressure on the top lane tower. As far as CS is concerned, it's pretty even, with the exception of those AD carries. Adrian, Godfred obviously having the advantageous lane because Enraged blew that flash at level 1.
Yeah, and they haven't been pressured out since either. No way could Sven get up to the top side without knowing where Evelynn is. You don't want to take that engage, especially with Alistar having been so low for a lot of the laning phase. So there's a big CS lead up there for Adri.
Yeah, and it feels like Giants are doing some weird and wonderful things, because Whirlip has now gone from the jungle to mid lane. Peppy backed so he could pick up that Aether Wisp. Yes, Godfrey's got himself some Moby boots, but again, Giants seem to be spending a lot of time moving around the lanes without necessarily being in the lanes.
Yeah, it is quite curious, actually, how they've done this movement across the map. As you said, ooh, Sven actually dropping low himself. Got that alert health ping. But yeah, it's very curious, actually, that Whirlip is now 2v2ing with Godfred against Candy Panda and Enrated, because Whirlip is still going to have to step forward for this CS, so they have to be careful that Ricochet and Boomerang Blade doesn't do too much damage in this. But Ezreal certainly is comfortable to sit up in that top lane against Freddy. I just wonder how this is going to affect the Dragon control. And you can actually see there between Candy Panda and Enrated a little bit of miscommunication on who was taking that binding, because Candy Panda actually used his spell shield. So they have to tighten that up a little bit more if they want to do well in this game.
We'll find out if any of those communication issues do become a problem. I want to highlight that Candy's already backed and pick up that pickaxe from early on. Thrown down on the hunt. This is a teleport from Freddy as well. You see Freddy, he's going to throw down the flame spritz. Equalizer comes out, and this is a 3v3. Frederick gets the black shield because Godfred was around. And SK invests everything for nothing, unfortunately. But it does give them control of Dragon.
It does give them control of Dragon. And the play that Giants are going to do from this is Adri is just pushing top lane in response. He just used his ultimate, so no chance of a steal. I kind of like this from Giants when it comes to how they're playing this game. They recognize that they can never really fight a Rumble around a Dragon. They can't give away too many early Dragons, though, because their composition will rely on them a little bit later into the game. However, getting turrets early is going to give Jax extra gold, and Jax with more freedom around the map because turrets are down is going to be able to split push deeper into the enemy side of the map.
Yeah, please keep an eye on Adri. He's still not backed. But as tower goes down, he should be about 2,800 or so gold. 2,900, in fact. A lot of money to spend on itemization. So SK get the dragon. They do not have teleport priority or teleport control. Whirlip's held onto his. Giants secure the first tower objective of the game.
SK is sitting on a fair amount of gold as well for themselves, but with no dragon to fight for, I kind of feel like SK, they're going to be okay with sitting on gold for a while and just farming up. One really interesting thing from Adri is picking up this Manamune as a first item here on Ezreal. Now, what this signifies to me is that he wants to go the Iceborne Gauntlet route. Because of the way two Sheens work together in the game, you can't get both Trinity Force and Iceborne Gauntlet, otherwise they're just not cost efficient at all. So this way, I would imagine later into the game, he's going to look to pick up the Gauntlet and then kite around and just deny SK's ability to engage later into the game.
I'll see if he decides to go for that blue build Ezreal, I believe, coined last year. Was particularly popular for an extended period of time, and Adri, with all that lone farming time, still sits on that 15 or so CS advantage over Candy. Pretty much even mid, pretty much even top. And other than the tower and the dragon, it's just been fairly standard lanes. But look at this, the swap is now mirrored by SK. They've thrown Adri down bottom, Whirlip up top, and it looks like Candy Panda and Freddy have replied in kind.
Yeah, which is interesting from Freddy's perspective, because he's not getting particularly far ahead, if anything, against this this Jax. And when you look at it, yes, teleport isn't available, but neither is Dragon. So now his impact on other areas of the map is a little bit diminished. But what this will do for SK is deny Adri's ability to just push in that bottom lane turret, because Rumble will just clear the waves away. So now Giants really only have a couple of options, and that's to look towards that mid turret if they really want to group there. But they're actually grouping top. There's no turret or objective up here for Giants, so this is a little bit of a misplacement of where their pressure is on the map.
Well, they went to Candy Panda, apparently. But they're not going to get him this time round. Reposition themselves towards the middle lane. I think they caught a glimpse of Fox recalling. Didn't actually have vision there, but if they stick around, they might get a little bit of alone time on that middle outer turret. Giants, 1,500 gold ahead. Happy to continue farming this up. Pepinero is level 9, getting closer and closer to that level 11 that we hear Power of Evil talk about so frequently. And then it's a matter of, can he land those artilleries?
And as we said in Champion Select, all Giants need is time for their composition to really start reaching their power spikes. SK, I'd like to see a couple more plays like this where they're grouping to push down these outer towers earlier on. They've not actually made a play like that. It is tricky when you don't have a read exactly on where everybody is. And with Evelynn. That's a lot more difficult to do here for SK. But now she's shown herself in the middle lane. You know there can't possibly really be three people top unless Kog'Maw has run all the way up there. So SK could look to pressure down the turret, but they've already left the lane, and it's Fox that's roaming himself. He's looking for Adri in this bottom lane. He has his ultimate.
Yeah, he's gonna find him. Look at the... Wow, didn't even need it. Blade of the Ruined King used, no death mark required. And Fox gets an assist on the board. Fox actually played Zed 7 times during the course of the spring split. 6 of those were victories, Chris. So a 6-1 record is fantastic. But he's given 13 minutes and only an assist on the board. At some point, it's going to be difficult for him to find targets.
Yeah, and at the same time, Giants reacted by shoving the lane in as well. So yes, it is good for... Ooh, Fox goes over the wall.
Deathmark carries Frederick in. The pop may be enough. No, because the shield from Agony's Embrace keeps Frederick alive. That Fox is actually following through on that flash and ends up now with SK having control of this middle lane.
So a very important thing happened a couple of seconds ago as SK are pushing into this mid turret. They're going to get good damage on this, but won't be able to get it quite yet. Willib used his teleport to get back to the top lane after the bottom lane engage. And that means that Freddy's going to have teleport advantage for this next dragon. And that's going to be a very key factor here because it means Freddy can either be at the dragon and then teleport to stop the Jax, or vice versa. Godfred flashes.
Oh, he tried to predict the flash and didn't manage to connect this time, but I like the confident play. It also means Candy Panda, no flash if team fights are to follow forward for Jax or Evelynn, so maybe sink their teeth in.
Yeah, that's going to be a little problematic for Candy Panda when it comes to this dragon fight. As we said, about a minute away. I don't feel like Giants want to really take that dragon, though.
Well, we'll find out if they can. You can see the coaches in the bottom of your screen. Lucas and Lozak, keeping an eye on their respective teams. It's pretty even so far. Maybe just stacking that T. I think he's going to pick up that Luden's Echo.
Well, at least he can remember what it is. Some of us have trouble remembering what a Luden's Echo is these days, but yes, he certainly does pick up that Luden. Not quite level 11, though, so not able to have that extended range on the Kog'Maw ultimate, but Giants are actually positioning themselves for this, and now they have two options. Either Jax runs down, or they sacrifice this fight. Candy Panda's getting work done at the same time in this mid lane, shoving it in, forcing Kog'Maw to come to the mid lane and rear his head. And that means, again, SK are keeping track of exactly where on the map Giants are. Giants still have a gold lead, though, and that is very important because, as we said, they're looking to scale.
Well, double AD comps, if they fall behind early, they tend to get overrun. However, if they do well early, they tend to take control in the mid-game. Calling Kog'Maw an AD is not necessarily fair because he's an AP poke machine.
Yeah.
Landing artillery after artillery. That's what we talked about. Candy Panda chunk down. No on the hunt if a fight were to break out. Whirlip is making no movements, though, towards the dragon.
Yeah, and when he shows top, that should be SK's signal to just continue to pressure this dragon. And in fact, it is, because they know there's no way he can possibly get that. So it's already shoved in towards the Giants as well. So it's not like Jax is going to get any work done in that top lane either. Can they get a steal, though?
True Shot Barrage plus Living Artillery. It's not going to be enough. Svenskeren smites that one down. But that got a little hairy. And SK take Dragon number 2. They also claw back some of that gold deficit.
Yeah, that was from that tower that Zed got a little bit earlier. But ooh, Zed actually locks down in the middle lane. All Giants need to do is just take this tower from range. They don't actually need to push too far forward in here because the fact that Fox is so low health, he's just going to get poked by Pepinero. And Pepinero has been fairly quiet thus far in this game, but he loves these sieging style champions. We know he plays Xerath a lot. Recently, he's actually been playing a lot more burst mages when it comes to it. We saw the Diana play yesterday. So Pepinero, again, another player from Giants showing more versatility in the summer split than we saw out of him in spring.
Yeah, but definitely still putting his carry pants on, that's for sure.
Yeah.
I distinctly remember his Xerath last week trying to flash over walls to land Arcano Pulses. Godfred, again, trying to anticipate and predict Candy Panda. They're going to get the teleport from Freddy, and it's going to finish, in fact. Equalizer available, and there's two members of Giants not yet. The Equalizer does not do anything. Darkbinding will lock Svenskeren in place, ooh, and the Black Shield was up! So Godfred manages to survive the prison, but not the knockout from Enraged.
Fox wants this. Does he know this too?
Oh, I don't think that he does. He's going to go over the wall with the shadow. Here comes Wurlib. The flash Arctic Assault did not connect, and Sven is going to back away, but they did manage to chase Wurlib and Frederick away. I think Audrey was able to secure that bottom tower while it was going on. So a kill for a tower again. A trade Giants will be happy with.
And it's the fact that Audrey was bottom lane that signified that engage from SK. But one thing that I want to talk about Godfred doing actually pretty well in that engage was the spacing between himself and the rest of his team as they were kiting back. And the black shield being on him meant that Sven could never get a coincidental ultimate where he fires it at Morgana and it clips somebody else to get that stun. So really nice out of Godfred. Yes, he dies from it. It's a fairly basic thing when it comes to supports and kiting back, but it saved Giants very well in that little engage in the top lane. But this Giants competition is all built around making sure they've always got somebody in a side lane pushing. And so far, it's working. Three towers on the board compared to the one tower on the board from SK.
We'll see if they can keep up this level of pressure. Giants have held on to that middle tower for a while. Small, small gold leads continuing to build up. Svenskier has actually picked himself up a Sightstone on that jungle Sejuani, as well as the Cinder Hulk. Still feels like he's playing Lee Sin, despite not playing Lee Sin. Whereas Candy Panda is farming his way up. Got about 1,300 gold, so we'll be able to finish that Eye Edge very soon. As soon as he goes back. But not on the same level as Audrey for the moment. Nearly 1,000 gold down. That's of course to their farm and the additional global objectives.
Mid tower is finally going to fall for SK, and this might actually cause them to breathe a bit of a sigh of relief, because mid tower is so integral to pushing up into your enemy's side of the base, because you get a lot more control around the middle section of the river and the jungles, the entrances, and you can track the enemies to know that they're far enough away for you to keep pushing. So the fact that that tower is now down is going to benefit SK a touch, but honestly, they haven't looked too well off from it yet, but Fox may not want this fight.
Not against a Trinity Force Cutlass Wurlib. He's 1v1-ing Fox, making it look easy. This is why Jax was banned last split and why he was banned last week.
Just when you think you've got Wurlib's all figured out, he changes the questions on you. You start looking at not banning him because he's going to pick Maokai, going to pick maybe a Hecarim. Nope, straight back to the Jax. You've given it to me. I have the freedom to do it. And Giants right now, Jax really isn't even at his full potential. He still hasn't got a finished Blade of the Rune King. Yes, he still has a lot of damage as it is. Don't get me wrong, but Jax is only going to get stronger. And this is an on-the-20-minute Baron call from the Giants, but they're thinking twice about this because SK are around. Man, that damage.
Oh, Sven Skerry gets poked down. Ooh. Living artillery. Plus one more Mystic Shot. And Audrey snipes down the Battle Pig from afar.
The question was, Sven is playing like a tank while not playing tanks. He's playing a tank and he got caught out again in the jungle. This is almost the same thing that happened to SK when Sven was playing Nidalee. He treads too close to the line and it just does not work out for SK again and again.
That's the truth. However, that line is so far against an Ezreal Kog'Maw. It's so, so difficult, but it is Sven Skerren once again, 1-1, going down and letting Giants take control.
The line is a dot, Trevor, at this rate for Sven Skerren. But this double sieging kind of ranged poke champion setup that Giants have could be caught out in the bottom lane.
Well, Audrey's in a little bit of trouble. Deathmark comes down. Ooh. He will be going down. It is Candy Panda that secures the kill secure. Wurlib is now looking for more. He's managed to stun and rate it up under the tower. Look at Pepinero. He's in the jungle, but he's low on mana. So he needs to be a little careful of the spam. SK grab themselves an outer turret and a kill and still remain within touching distance of their opponents.
Yeah, it's going to slow Giants down for a while now because I don't think they're really going to want to try that Baron bait again anytime soon. They actually have a little bit of an issue when it comes to their top lane. They can't actually put anybody up there because it's pushing away from them. So they have to wait for SK to go and push that back while they wait for Dragon to respawn. That could be a good timer here for SK because once again, Dragon is due up and Wurlib does not have his teleport. This time, Wurlib is in the bottom side of the map anyway, so he's able to sit around here for this Dragon fight.
So we'll see if a bigger engage happens. Previously, Giants sort of gave up the second Dragon. Despite being aware of it, they did try steal, they did try snipe. True Shot Barrage is up. No Soul Shatters from Godfrey. Let's seems like SK have pulled the Dragon out of its pit. Candy Panda takes a shot for his troubles, and Wurlib now moving in from the side. Enraged, so, so close to getting caught out. It looks like SK have peeled away, not looking for the fight. Giants have, in fact, taken the aggro, and SK are the ones that have given up this objective.
SK can't sit in front of two poking champions like this. Freddy actually just bails out, uses his teleport to go collect farm in the top side of the map. And that was the thing for SK, is they have great team fighting, but if they can never engage onto Giants in the way that they want, they are just going to get poked down as they sit in front of these objectives. Now they sit in front of the tower. Freddy is top lane. Candy Panda just recalled as well. It's lucky they can just clear that small wave in front of the tower, so it buys them more time. But Giants are not going to let up this pressure anytime soon, because, oh, On the Hunt has been popped.
Well, we do see a double Glacial Prism from Svenskeren. They've jumped onto Pepinero, and he will get taken out. True Shot Barrage snipes down Svenskeren from the side, and the Acathian Surprise puts a little more damage onto SK. That's a good equalizer from Freddy, burning Frederick down. He does have Flash available if he wants to go over the wall, but he's not going to need it, as the only threat was Enrated. A trade, one for one. Svenskeren gave his life to take that of Pepinero.
Minor trades that SK are getting here, and again, they just cannot afford to give Giants any kills in any time here in this game at all. But for SK Gaming, what they have to do is we take another look at this replay. This is what they have to do, really. Great ultimate here from Svenskeren. Catches both of the damage dealers from the Giants, but nobody can turn around onto Adri here, and SK are just a little bit too far back. Look, Candy Panda's actually not able to output any damage for the entirety of this fight. All he was here for was his ultimate earlier on, and then Giants regroup. Wurlib gets himself back to the front of the fight, and it's a lot more scary for SK to sit there.
Let's see what Candy Panda can do to get himself back into this match. 1-0-2. Farming very well. Phantom Dancer completed. Infinity Edge completed. From a damage perspective, he's going for the maximum damage route. A lot of wave clear between Zed and Sivir, so not feeling the shiv this time around. We see a QSS picked up on the side of Wurlib to cleanse away that Glacial Prison. Or Deathmark, I guess.
Yeah.
Not that he needed it, because it didn't work last time.
It didn't work out well for Fox last time. You know, that QSS, as you said, multiple utilities in this game. I'm still interested to see where that Adri is going to go for the Ice Pong Gauntlet, because if they can just keep denying SK's ability to engage. The other thing that Ice Pong Gauntlet will do is slow people so that Pepe can hit them with his ultimate again and again and again, and just keep landing the poke all the time from Giants. Wurlib. Oh, he's in another lane again.
Well, once more, Wurlib does have access to teleport. We saw the True Shot Barrage come out. On the Hunt comes up. They throw onto Godfrey. That's a very good equalizer once more from Freddy, and Wurlib has already got himself a kill. Taken Fox out. That was a great teleport in from behind. Frederick's up top. Well, Enrated's going to get focused down. Double kill for Wurlib. Who's next on the list? Frederick turns back to focus down Enrated, and it will be a double kill for Frederick as well. Four clean kills after SK started the fight.
Great teleport timing out from Wurlib. It was as if they were waiting for it, just baiting SK towards them. And that's one thing Wurlib has actually been really good with, is his reaction timings on teleport. Gets to the fight, Fox is already low, and it's an easy pickup for the Giants in that massive 4-0 team fight, and they're gonna take a Baron from this. Giants, again, are just in full control of the game.
Very well played indeed. No threat here from SK, but there's no tankiness from Giants. They're juggling the aggro. Getting a little low, but they secure the Baron at 27 minutes. And here's a replay of that fight.
So Fox can't get into this fight on anybody other than Godfrey. And once Fox realizes he's never going to be able to all-in, he has to get away. And at that point, Wurlib just completely picks him off. And from here, this is just the difference in Giants being ahead and how much extra damage they have that SK just cannot reply with. Nobody on SK is tanky enough yet, because they only really have the duration when Alistar ult is running and Sejuani's itemization to keep them alive.
Well, the small irony of this Sejuani pick is the fact that against the AP Cog and the Ayres and the Jax, you actually wanted an early game jungler to make an impact, to shut them down and slow them down. Because SK played so passively It allowed Pepinero to get all of these item spikes, 280 CS, Luden's completed, working his way towards an Hourglass most likely as well. And it is the Iceborne for Audrey as well.
And that Hourglass is going to make it so that Fox really has no targets here, because Ezreal, he should never get in ultimate range of because of that Iceborne Gauntlet as it is. But, you know, just honestly, this SK lineup, we talked about, I talked about yesterday, jungle champions, and when the S tier junglers are banned, the very top tier, you go to your second tier, and for Sven, we know it's the snowball heavy junglers, and he's actually gone to what I guess you could consider like a B tier here in a jungler that he tends to shy away from in Sejuani, because it's not his playstyle, and it just is not working for them. The rest of Sven's picks that he would normally pick were available.
Yeah, unfortunate for this time around. Freddy's Rumbleton markedly improved as these later team fights have rolled on, but unfortunately, Zed and the Sivir are just not working out. Wurlip plus Frederick now in a 2v2. And they pop Freddy before he can even pop the Hourglass. He's down, and Giants now set their targets on the inner turret. They've got Baron-empowered minions. And for Giants, they've now got the tools they need to close this game out. They're going to keep pushing SK down 25 seconds before Freddy can even come to defense.
Yeah, SK, all the options they have right now is sit here and hope that Giants make a mistake, because they're not really going to do anything to Giants here. Look at how fast Wurlip is taking down that turret. The satisfying sound, the thwack of Wurlip on Jax just hammering away the turret. Now the rest of Giants are here. This turret should be going down here.
Yeah, many people consider that sound the best sound in League of Legends. I argue that Warwick hitting a turret is better. However, not everybody knows that one, so we'll see. Wurlip now sets himself up on the bottom lane. He's going to jump onto Can. No, that was Fox, rather. Fox is in trouble. He gets stunned up. Wurlip now is going to get focused by four more members. And it's Candy Fan that gets the kill. Sven Skeren stands up Audrey, but the true shot, Mirage, plus a hate spike, managed to secure themselves a boar. Freddy's in retreat. Dark Binding is going to get Hourglass. I don't think it would have hit anyway. One more snipe from Pepinero secures yet another kill. 12-5, 10,000 gold lead. Inhibitor down. Giants have just broken the backs of SK Gaming.
Oh, you cannot escape from Iceborne Gauntlet Ezreal. It is perhaps the most obnoxious build that I think an AD carry can have. Not always the best suited for the occasion, but certainly for this game, it is working wonders with the coordination with Pepinero's ultimate. This is the first time Giants have really cared about a dragon. Yes, they got one earlier from a fight, but this is the first time they're the ones at the dragon pit first. They've just focused on towers and kills a lot more in this game. And here's Fox using his ult to try and escape. Not gonna work against the Jax that's this fed, but honestly, again, this ult is maybe as good as Sven's gonna get in this situation. Godfrey's ultimate tried to tank it, but he actually caught Audrey as the ultimate fired, but no escape for Freddy and the rest of SK and in their own base.
Not this time round. Wow, what a game from Giants. We see again, this is Giants looking to go 3-1 and SK to go 0-4 if the game closes out, which it should. But I really just want to talk about Giants, because on PTL this week, I was talking about sort of pretenders and contenders for the Summer Split title.
Yeah.
And I felt that Giants were leaning more towards the pretender side, because I felt they were going to be slightly weaker than the likes of SK, than the likes of Elements, even Copenhagen Wolves. And the reason I say those three teams is because those are the teams that Giants are have beaten.
Yeah.
Giants are taking out these teams that are in the sort of, you know, 6th through 10th position and setting themselves up, at least early on, to look at maybe a playoff spot if they can keep this level of performance, if they can keep this level of control.
Well, the fact that they've already bagged those wins makes it fairly important for Giants. It's the same as when you look at a traditional sports setup, is like picking up wins against teams around you in the table is the absolute most important thing to do, more important than upsetting the top team, because those are the points that are definitely going to matter at the end of the season. Yes, you can pick up a surprise win here or there against the likes of a Fnatic, but honestly, just consistently being better than people who are at your level is going to go so much further for Giants to get themselves into a playoff spot. Honestly, when you look at some of the other teams right now that just haven't been able to keep up with the growth in the European scene, Giants are looking towards that mid-tier table to kind of set up.
Looking forward to seeing how they handle themselves. The only loss that Giants have suffered was to Origin, their very first game of the split. that. It feels like it was so long ago. These Giants are just dismantling SK Gaming. Frederick has now found Candy Panda, and we see Pepinero throwing down those living artilleries. They have given up a killer. That's a great Glacial Prison. Giants all of a sudden may have bitten off more than they can chew. Candy Panda gets on the board, but the carries of Pepinero and Audrey are still alive and poking from afar. Fox gets out. Despite losing two, it's SK in retreat.
Yeah, the respect that SK are giving right now to the ability for Giants to kite them around is pretty incredible. As you said, 3 versus 5, SK still backing away because they had fairly low health bars when it came to things. This is a pause button for the Giants right now, but I feel like that pause button is going to hit play again when this Baron respawns in just under 30 seconds time. And honestly, SK, they've started to run out of options, but team fights like that, mistakes from Giants, trying to get the flank when you really don't have it on an Evelynn, and ending up 1 versus 5, that's the kind of thing that's going to let SK back into this game.
Agreed, and props to Svenskeren as well for landing another good Glacial Prison. I think he's missed one of them this game, but it was on a Leaping Jack, so we'll forgive that one. But other than that, he seemed to have found Audrey or Pepinero in most fights.
Yeah, most of them that haven't hit have just been tanked by Godfrey with the Dark Binding, but oh, there's the Dark Binding with the Black Shield, I mean. But Giants, they've teleported in. Inhibitor has minions pushing in the mid lane. They want to fight this.
And the longer they stall SK, the more those minions can do. Looks like the waves are pushing in favor of Giants. We'll see when they get met. Actually, top lane will meet them shortly. The Giants have pushed SK off of Baron. We know that the Spell Shield is down for Candy Panda. So that's going to allow Audrey to Arcane Shift in and secure the kill. Using that Spell Shield just to get some mana back in the Living Artillery. Wurlip is going to shut down Svenskeren and get the 14th kill of the game.
Sven knew before he hit his ult then that he was a gunner. There was no way of him getting out from that. And honestly, Giants don't even need the Baron right now. They are looking to just get Freddy inside the base and sit in front of those Nexus turrets. Flash forward from Pepinero! Picks up the kill, and Giants are going to push for the win.
They are onto the Nexus turrets. 5 versus 2. Sniping from downtown, and Raider does what he can to delay them, but it's too little and too late, I'm afraid. Giants will be getting caught by the Troll Inhibitor. Actually, that might buy a little bit of time. We'll see. The Inhibitor's going to get dropped shortly. Wurlib's on retreat, but Giants, what a great win.
Sven used his ult. They can't engage in this situation, so Giants will just deal out a lot of damage, take down Sven again, and Giants are looking great.
That's it. 3-1 in the summer split. Giants deconstruct SK Gaming, and Wurlib's Jax is taking everything, causing SK to give up their 4th loss of the split. And look at broken faces. Because SK went meta. I mean, with the exception of that Zed, everything felt meta. Yeah. Giants did not, but they pick up the win.
I mean, well, Giants defaulted back to a kind of a playstyle that has worked well for them with that Jax, but this double siege comp, or double long-range poke composition, I think, is a great adaptation from the Giants here. Again, it shows that they're evolving their playbook. They're not just relying on Pepinero to dive in and blow somebody up massively. And another growth, I think, is safe to say the Giants showed in this game was a lot slower at the beginning of the game. We talked about last week, they gave up 9 deaths when they picked up 5 kills before 15 minutes in the first 2 games. This time, a lot slower, so much more patient by the Giants.
And what we're learning, once an AP cog in the middle hits level 11, you are even in gold and even in skill, that AP cog has a very good chance of winning. I think back to Incarnations games from NA, I think back to Power of Evil tweeting about it and hearing himself playing that champion. And it's all about level 11. It just seems like that's the magic number, but it's so difficult to get there without giving up things. And the Giants today made it look easy.
Especially against like a Zed in lane who is going to try and all in you at level 6. Level 11 so far away that the promised land of being able to just poke people down with your ult for so long. But Fox was back to an assassin on Zed. It just didn't work out. Good pressure in the middle lane from Frederick. SK never really had the control around that middle lane to set it up for themselves. And quite frankly, you could say that about the entire map.
You definitely could. I'm taking a look at the damage graphs. And, you know, over the course of the game, Frederick's Evelynn dealt more damage than Freddy's Rumble.
Wow.
That is a very, very scary stat. And then, you know, obviously the poking from, from Pepe Nero. That dealt more damage than Fox and Candy Panda combined.
So that actually highlights a bit of a problem for SK Gaming. Freddy, we used to call him Steady Freddy. Last week, I believe he went 1-12 over the week, this time not able to output damage on a rumble.
Yeah.
SK are not working around Freddy at all, and Freddy himself just isn't able to get himself rolling.
I completely agree. Freddy and Sven are the two players that I'm looking at in the summer split that have simply not stepped up. Fox and Azir looked pretty good, but unfortunately hasn't been able to carry. And you know, for SK, it's a difficult situation, 0-4. Right now, we're going to throw it to Pyrotechnics on stage, who is standing by with a member.